Welcome to GameFellas, the retro to modern gaming podcast, episode 13. We can just call
the
beginning.
Lucky 13.
I know, right? We can just call this the beginning of season 2, 2020. We're back, and we have with us Justin Day, who did not fall asleep tonight.
Not tonight. Now
despite
I'm here.
Despite it being past midnight, I think, in the UK. So thank you, Justin, as always, for staying up. We have Mark MSX from Frozen, Idaho.
Yep. Hanging in there.
Tonight? How you doing tonight, Mark?
Pretty good. Just got off work.
Ah, got off work and rushed in.
Yep, and, exactly.
Yeah. And we got our special featured guest, Lance John, friend of the show, old friend of mine. How you doing, Lance?
I'm good. I'm good. I'm trying to not to freeze also in New York City.
Yeah, Lance is in New York City in the other frozen north on the west of the, East Coast with me. Mm. And Lance runs his own podcast network called the Gifted Sounds Network with a plethora of different podcasts you can listen to. And later on, we will let him talk all about that and tell you where you can find that. So before we get to our topics, why don't we talk a little bit about what we've been playing? So Lance, you being the guest, you start us off, man. What you been playing lately?
So lately I've been playing a whole lot of Borderlands 3 for the PC. It's something, it's kind of like a tradition. I've been playing with my fiance. We've been playing since part one, and it's like every, you know, whatever they release, we're like, all right, let's jump on it, let's see all the weird shit we can, you know, find, and the guns and all this other nonsense. And she's more or less fell in love with that, but oddly enough she's more into the Division 2, which is, you know, completely different type of gameplay and whatnot, but it's pretty much that's all we've been like playing, or I've been playing a lot of. It's just either the Division 2 or Borderlands 3.
Division 2 is more, is online only, right? Is that like an online like battle arena type game, or is it, or is it like more like Call of Duty type
thing? It's actually, well, yeah, it's not online only. You could play it offline if you want to. It's more or less your, it's dystopian future. You're in, I think, yeah, in Washington, D.C. this time. There's a virus that released on, like, somebody released a dirty bomb, which infected money and got a lot of people killed pretty much that way. So then you're like this agent called, they're part of this thing called the Division, and like you're activated to go and like shoot everybody you can find. It's like,
in doubt.
Yeah. Yep. And it's, you, there is a huge online element to it, where you like, you can, you know, send out a ping so you need help, or you could join people with the missions, and you know, there's like a bunch of story missions, there's all these side things you can do, high value targets and whatnot. It's like a third person shooter with a very futuristic twist to it, where everything is more or less in this like Division tech, which is like in your watch, which is called Isaac. And you can see your entire map, hear a lot of different things. You have drones, you have like bombs that, like grenades that would like either heal you or go out, split off into a bunch of different little ones and just, you know, mess up enemies and stuff like that.
Okay. But,
and it can get pretty brutal at times. It's a pretty interesting game.
Okay, cool. That's cool that your fiance plays with you, or at least in Borderlands. Yeah, I played through the first two Borderlands with a buddy of mine, had a great time. I haven't got to Borderlands 3 yet. I'm kind of waiting for it to come on Steam. I'm one of those guys. So
no, hey, I mean, if you, when it, I mean, I'm kind of upset it wasn't on Steam this time around, because you do get a lot of really good deals when it comes to the DLCs and stuff like that, but yeah, not so, this time around.
No, on Epic.
Did it come out on console or just Epic?
I think it's on everything.
Yeah, it's on PS4 and Xbox also, I think.
Oh, okay.
But I wanted it on PC because my buddy doesn't have any consoles. He just has a PC that I can do it. So,
yeah, it's fun on PC for sure.
Yeah, definitely. All right, cool. Anything else, man? Or is that it?
I mean, other than that, I've been wanting to play more of Switch games.
Yep.
But I bought it. Just kind of sits there and catches dust. But I think I'm going to start doing that. I'll probably jump on like Luigi's Mansion, whatever the latest one
is.
Yeah,
Luigi's Mansion 3. Yep.
Yeah, so because I do have a bit of an hour commute back in, like, well, it's 2 hours total for me back and forth from work.
Yeah,
so.
you city folk, yeah, taking the subway and the bus and everything else.
Subway's terrible.
Oh yeah, God. Man, New York subway. Yeah. When I was in New York, we wanted to ride the subway, but we didn't get to. I think a couple years ago when we were there, but maybe that's a good thing.
I would say if you can skip it, do it. It's just like, you know.
All right, cool. Well, thanks, Lance. Mark, let's move on to you, man. What you been playing? Hey. What shmups have you been playing lately?
All the shmups.
Yeah, all the shmups.
I played a ton because I did this top 25 of the 2010s.
Yeah, I have. I saw. Yeah.
Yeah, so I had to go back and revisit a bunch of them. I'm trying to think what I've been playing the most. Danmaku Unlimited 3, which is on the Switch for people who, you know, interested in Switch games. I'm doing a live demonstration of that in February, so I've been playing that a ton to try and, you know, get polished up for the live run. So that's mostly what I've been playing.
Live but run for what?
For an event I'm hosting called SHMUP Slam, where it's kind of like...
Okay, right.
Yeah, it's kind of like AGDQ, but instead it's all online live runs.
Yep.
Because shmup players live all over the world, and trying to get us all together in one spot's like impossible. Yeah. So I've been doing a lot of that in the non-shmup sphere. I remember when I did my top games in the last episode, and one of them I was like, I think this one would be, if I played it. It was Sekiro, I think, Shadows Die Twice.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so I got that and played it. I got it on the Steam sale. Yeah,
the Dark Souls that's not Dark Souls, basically.
Yeah, exactly.
From Software, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's got kind of the feudal Japan vibe going on it. My review was, when I was playing it, I was really digging it. It's basically, if you guys know about Tenchu, that was a PS1 and PS2 series that actually were From Software's first games before Dark Souls.
Okay.
It's a ninja stealth game. Anyway, I think like Sekiro is a realization of what they were kind of going for back in the day, but they couldn't quite pull
successor.
It off. Yeah, basically, yeah. I think it was even planned to be in the series, and then they changed their minds. So it's very close to those, but it has more Dark Souls-y type elements and stuff as well. So I was really digging it, but I found that compared to, I guess, like Dark Souls 3 or Nioh, you know, those other Souls games, about halfway through, it does start to feel a little tedious a bit. So I wouldn't say it's as strong as something like Dark Souls 3, but it's still a really good game.
Why does it start to feel tedious as opposed to the Dark Souls games? Well, what's the difference?
Well, okay, well, the big difference is the combat system. And the combat system is very... It has a lot of counters. I think they got that idea from Nioh, to be honest, where you use a lot of counters. And at first, I'm like... Oh yeah, I love counters. This is going to be badass.
The opposite, I hate counters.
Well, it's pretty fun, but then once you get to realize that basically the entire combat system is just countering, like that's pretty much it, then it starts to feel actually less interesting than the Dark Souls games and stuff, or especially Nioh, where you can counter in that game, but you can do other stuff. But in Sekiro, it's whenever you're up against a boss, you're like, okay, how do I beat this boss? You counter, like you just learn how to counter all their attacks and stuff. So it felt a little tedious after a while.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. I was having enough problems with the countering in the Jedi Fallen Order, so like I can't, and that was like a secondary thing there, so I can't imagine what it's probably like in that game.
Still a really good game though.
Yeah. So what else, man?
So I did that, and then I played a bunch of Switch games to try, and I did a review. It's another shmup. So I'm trying to think of some non-shmup activities I've been up to.
All right, man, you're the shmup team, so you don't yeah. No problem talking about it.
Yeah, so I did a review of Esperade Sai. That's Japanese exclusive right now. It hasn't come out in the West. It's a cave game. It came out for the Nintendo Switch. You can get it on the eShop if you have the JPN account and all that. So I actually did a review for Nintendo Life for that. They approached me and they're like, hey, do you want to review this for us? I was like, okay. So I did that.
That's cool.
That's pretty cool. So I've been doing a lot of kind of editorial gameplay, which isn't my usual thing, but that's what I've been up to mostly. Where, you know, you're like playing a game, but you're playing it to review it rather than to
sit and play it. The least fun way to play a game, in my opinion.
It totally is, because when you're playing it, you can't get lost in the game. You're like, oh snap, I gotta screenshot this, or I gotta write a note here. You know, it's just not the same. So I get why like people who are just professional game reviewers start to hate games after a while, because
it becomes your job. Yeah,
it's all they do. Yeah,
understandable. So, okay, all right. Thank you, Mark. Let's move on to Justin. What you been playing, Justin? I'm sure whatever it is, it's on the Switch.
No, you'll be really surprised. I haven't I haven't been able to put down Google Stadia.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah, is that really? Do you hear that they're talking about buying up exclusives like Epic's been doing? That's the latest.
That's the latest thing. To be honest, I thought for Christmas I'd put down my intolerance of Google Stadia, but now it's a new year and a new chance for me to go and piss on their chips. So I thought I'd get that out early doors. No, I've not been doing anything with Google Stadia because anyone who enjoys video games doesn't want 4 seconds of lag. So what I did over Christmas was I went and purchased, because I don't need this because I've already got a backlog of games, but I went and purchased a whole load of games to play over Christmas because I had some time off. Because I spent a bit of time on a couple of RPGs, I kind of wanted some sort of 10 to 20 hour type games. I can't remember the website. This is terrible. We should look this up. If we had a producer, we should do this. My friend...
I'll be producer.
Well, my friend told me about a website, which I've forgotten. It's called like How Long to Beat. Do you know it? HowLongToBeat.com? Something like that. Basically, it's a community that's growing. It's fantastic. And it's very simple.
Yeah,
it tells you how long to complete the game, how long to complete the game if you're kind of wandering around a bit, and how long to like 100% it. Every game they kind of like boom, boom, boom. So
really glad you showed this to me because this is exactly what I need to.
Mate, this is an epic resource because
Sounds fun.
It's great because you know that if I can complete the game within 15 hours, I know what I'm getting myself in for. If it's 100 hours, I know what I'm getting myself in for. So it's become a really invaluable resource. Anyway, the point of that is I got some games that were under kind of 15 hours. So in no particular order, are you familiar with Yooka, Laylee?
Yes.
Okay, good.
That's the
Banjo-Kazooie team.
Yeah, Banjo-Kazooie sequel, right? Yeah,
it isn't.
Kickstarted last year or the year before.
That's correct. Yeah. So the guys from the original sort of Banjo-Kazooie production team now go under the company Playtonic. And this is the 2D follow-up to the 3D game. So this is Yooka-Laylee and the Impossible Lair. Just another classic outing from them. Fantastic. You get from it what you expect. 2D platforming game. It's got all of the things you'd expect. Collectibles, different time trials, blah, 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 blah. Fantastic. Nice and certainly not simple, reasonably challenging, but not grossly challenging. So that was a good bit of fun. I followed that up with a remake of a 3D platform game from the Xbox, which is on the Switch, called New Super Lucky's Tale. If I'm being perfectly honest, that was ludicrously simple. But again, if you just want some mind-numbing 3D platforming, away you go. I think I managed 100% that in just under 10 hours. That was pretty quick. But two that I'd rather focus on because I think they're fantastic. The first one is a game called Forager. Are you familiar with Forager?
Forager, no.
No.
Is it like a survival game in the wilderness or something?
It sounds like it. In many ways, it's a bit of a homage to games like Terraria and Stardew Valley.
Oh, okay.
So
I like it already.
But it's done in an even more simplistic way, and I found myself playing it and not understanding entirely why I couldn't put it down. It's fun, but at the same time, I was like, why can't I put this down? Because if you said to me, what's so unbelievably great about this game? I don't even know that I could tell you why, but I just enjoyed it. It has all of those different elements to it, the whole concept of foraging and building resources and a little bit of dungeon exploration and I just really, really enjoyed it. I thought it was very neatly put together, very, very cute, kind of pixel art type graphics. And I was genuinely disappointed when I kind of got to the point where I suppose I had completed it. And I've been bugging the guys who make the game on Twitter to make sure that they get the updates out onto the Switch more quickly because they've been kind of focusing on the PC.
Yeah. And they're actually listening to you. They're responding?
well, they liked my tweet, so I'm going to assume good. that's a bloody good start. So we'll go with that. So that was great, and I just hope that they get the updates out to the Switch sooner rather than later, because I would just love to pick that up again. And it's one of those sandbox type games that opens itself up to endless possibility. So they could build another 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 hours of content in there, which would be great. But finally, my current game that I'm playing, this is always one of those that amuses me when I try to explain to people I work with and humor me. This is a game called River City Girls. Have you heard of that?
No.
Yep.
Not.
Right.
River City Girls.
Well, I'm okay. You would be forgiven for thinking that it's some kind of panty collecting Japanese fetish game. It's not. just to make that clear. However, again, when you try to explain to your friends at work that you're playing a game where you are a Japanese schoolgirl trying to rescue your boyfriend, you do, of course, still get some odd looks. It is a game in the style of classics. It is.
Yeah, River City Ransom.
Yeah. Okay.
It's everything that is Double Dragon, Golden Axe, Streets of Rage, but again, put into a kind of a Japanese
great pixel art too. It's
yes,
a pixel art game. Yeah.
And it is fantastic. The story is pretty cool. The graphics are fantastic. The soundtrack, which is increasingly, I noticed this is commonplace, is available on Spotify. So you can play the songs through your Spotify account. Really, really strong. Really strong soundtrack. It's just super exciting. It's something that my kids would play with me as well. And
co-op, two players.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's just fun. It's just fun. And say the story is kind of a little bit zany, and
zany is a perfect word to describe what it looks like from what I could tell.
And that's what it is. And at the moment I'm kind of a portion of the way through it, and it's really gripped me. So I was quite looking forward to it before it came out. I got myself the physical version through Limited Run. Cool. That's where I'm currently at.
Okay, cool. Thank you, Justin. We'll move on to me, and my brother recently took a new job in North Carolina and moved out of the state. So before he left, me and him had a gaming day where we just played games all day. And the game we focused on was Xeno Crisis, which I've mentioned before a couple times. It was a game developed for the Sega Genesis through Kickstarter through the past few years, and it's a Super Smash TV type of gameplay, I guess is the best way to describe it, that with like mixed with Alien. And I hadn't really got a chance to really play it in co-op mode before I played with him, and so we played for probably 5 or 6 hours straight, and we couldn't beat it, that's how hard it is, but we had a blast. Very fun game. It's also out on every other platform imaginable: PlayStation, PC, Xbox, Switch, everything. I recommend picking it up. It's a lot of fun. Even in single player, it's fun. It's like a room-to-room type game. Scroll from room to room. You clear the room of enemies and you move on. You can buy upgrades and power-ups in between levels. And there's big boss fights. Very cool game. So there's that. Last night, for the sake of Mark, I played through Star Fox 64.
Oh, yeah.
For the first time since the late 90s, I think. Mark did a run through of the game, and me and him are going to be doing some commentary on that coming up pretty soon. So I'm going to continue with Star Fox before, the next day or two before we do that. But yeah, Star Fox 64, man. It's jankier than I remember, but not so much in the gameplay department as much as like, the really corny voices. And I'm sorry, Mark, but I still can't get into the circular stages where you're looping around
all range mode.
Yeah, the dog fights, man. I'm not a fan of those.
Gotta love all range mode.
It's awesome. I prefer the straight shooting segments, but yeah, dude, I mean, it's the gameplay is super solid. Like, it's fun. The tank wasn't as bad as I remembered. The tank was kind of fun.
No, the tank's hype.
Yeah,
Landmaster's hype.
Yep. So yeah, Star Fox 64, I'm experimenting with that. That was fun. The other game that took me way longer than it should have was Jedi Fallen Order. I finally finished that I guess it was last week. And my thoughts on that are, I enjoyed it quite a bit, but I feel like it was kind of, the difficulty was kind of unbalanced. Like, I was playing on basically normal mode and didn't have any problems in the main game, but the boss fights just kicked my ass, like really bad. Particularly the last couple boss fights where you have to fight this old Jedi guy in a temple. And I probably fought him 20 times before I could beat him, 25 times. I just could not do it. And then the final boss fight, I ended up hung my head in shame and I reduced the difficulty to easy. And I just beat her, and that was the end of it. I was like, fuck, I'm done.
Then you put down the controller and went.
I almost threw the controller a few times, man. Like, that's how frustrated I got with Fallen Order. Maybe I'm just not that great at action games like that. But the good things are, it's a lot of fun. I mean, because having a lightsaber and swinging it around and deflecting, laser bullets at stormtroopers is awesome. It was a lot of fun to do that. The story's pretty cool. And of course, no spoiler if you've seen the ads, but Darth Vader shows up at the end just spontaneously, which actually was kind of thrilling because I feel like whenever he shows up, like at the end of Rogue One, the movie where he showed up, that was just, whenever he shows up, shit's about to go crazy. And it's fun to see Darth Vader doing stuff, like that.
So if Vader's hanging around, when does this take place exactly?
It takes place about 5 to 10 years after the prequels. So this is when Vader is in his prime, going around the galaxy, being a tyrant. So, and you're supposedly one of the last Jedi that they couldn't hunt down. You were hidden. So once he finds out that you're alive, then he's after you.
Until
the end. But yeah, it's really cool. Like, the atmosphere is cool. The lore is very cool. It adds a lot to the lore. I feel like I enjoyed it. It's fun. Fallen Order is good. Once I finished that, I moved on to The Outer Worlds, so I'm playing that now. I'm about 5 or 6 hours in, and I love it. It's really cool. I'm trying to figure out how to explain it. A lot of people have said it's basically the spiritual successor to Fallout New Vegas, I guess.
I've heard all about this, yeah.
Yeah, Derek talked about it a lot in the previous episodes. It's like Fallout, except in a completely sci-fi setting on other planets where you have a ship fly between planets. And it's basically the frontier. Think of it like as the Western frontier in the United States, maybe back in the early 1800s or something. It's like that, except in space, almost Firefly, like kind of Firefly-esque, that sort of thing.
The Oregon Trail.
Yeah, right, the Oregon Trail. So, yeah, I'm really enjoying it.
Almost as good.
Yeah, the storyline is really interesting because it's all about, everything is owned by corporations, and corporations control everything, they own everything. So say a worker dies in town or something, the corporation taxes everybody in town to pay for the guy's funeral. It's that sort of thing, like really interesting, interesting story elements like that. So I'm not too super far in it yet, but I love the characters. Ashley Birch, who's one of my favorite voice actors working in games. She actually voices one of the, your main companions, which I didn't realize. I was like, man, this character is really good. And I looked it up and sure enough, it was her. She does Tiny Tina in the Borderlands games. And she did the main protagonist in Horizon Zero Dawn. She's done a bunch of great stuff. So props to her for doing a great character in that also. So that's what I've been playing. Want to move on to our first discussion topic. It is going to be, basically, we're going to do this in two parts. We're going to do, it's going to be a console versus PC then and now.
Let's do it.
Yeah, so basically, I'll read a little thing here. It could be argued that all video games are, in essence, PC games, right? Like, video games started on computers, I think back in the 1950s, one of the earliest games was this game called Tennis for Two. It was designed for the Donner Model 30 analog computer, which was at a large public expo in 1958, and I guess it was blew people's minds back then. It was a computer, in essence, right? So, as time progressed, hardware got better, and we got the Magnavox Odyssey in 1972, which was the first home video game console, but in essence, still a computer, right? This allowed for more specialized hardware, and console gaming was born. So that being said, PCs continued to evolve, and gaming on the platform along with it. but the types of games released on PC and console tend to vary widely. So why don't we explore the differences in PC and console gaming, you know, maybe from the 70s and 80s up till the 2000s or so. And then in our next section, we can talk about modern stuff. So Justin, man, why don't you, you're the guy who likes old computer gaming from the 1980s. So why don't you start us off, man? Give us your thoughts on this.
Yeah. This is probably my segment, isn't it?
The ZX Spectrum.
The Brits, you guys all had those computers.
Yeah, yes,
microcomputers.
Microcomputers.
I think this is probably an interesting place to start, actually, is for me to understand the difference between growing up in that era in the United Kingdom and also, you know, growing up in that era in the United States. So here in the United Kingdom, the rise of microcomputers and home computers trumped consoles. To start with, there was no concept of consoles finding their way over here as early as they did, I think, maybe over to America, or the popularity wasn't as big. So what we had here, certainly at the start of the 80s and that rise of bedroom gaming, we had the Sinclair ZX Spectrum. We had the Commodore 16 followed by the Commodore 64, which was my weapon of choice.
We had the Commodore 64 over here, but it was I think it was more of a niche thing over here than it was. Maybe it was more
niche
where you were.
We had one.
And it definitely was not niche over here.
Yeah.
It was humongous. And you also had the Amstrad. The CPC 464 was probably the big competitor there. They were the rise of bedroom gaming. I don't think consoles really kind of came into their own until sort of the late 80s. So we had the NES, the Nintendo, and the Sega Master System.
Did you really have the Master System over there that much?
About Sega, I believe.
Yeah. So Sega, the Master System was reasonably big here. I think the Nintendo probably fared better because of Mario, frankly, and Donkey Kong, and the kind of the stuff that had come out in the arcades. But what we also had as well, as you kind of went through the 16-bit era as well, the next step up was the Amiga. So if you spoke to people in the UK about the Amiga, so the Amiga 500, the 500 Plus, yep, and the 600, and then the 1200 to a degree, that for a lot of people was huge. So a lot of people had, an Amiga instead of a console, instead of a Mega Drive or a Super Nintendo.
And the Amiga started as 8-bit, and the 1200 was a 16-bit one, right? Which one was a 16-bit machine of the Amigas?
So of the Amigas, I would say they all were. They just had a different processing unit.
Yeah, you might be right.
The 1200 didn't actually fare as well. It was meant to be just a bit bigger and bulkier. The one that most people had was the 500 Plus, and that was on a par. I would say that was a 16-bit equivalent. So I suppose, kind of bringing it back on topic, what was popular, what was not, why did people go with one thing, why did they not? I think that one of the main reasons would be cost. So the cost of a games console was vastly less than the cost of a computer. That's a fact. I think the computer would have appealed to children in particular and young adults because of piracy. So it would have been Mark's weapon of choice, of course.
It was indeed.
Yeah. Cheap shot, but it's early in 2020. So people would more easily share tapes and discs. They were copyable. There's no concept of kind of anti-piracy really. Whereas,
bootleg those discs.
Just yeah. FYI, I'm going to play my producer role for a minute here. The Amigas were all 16-bit machines. The Amiga 1000 was the equivalent of $3,000 in 2019 money. So
what we're saying is that British people were loaded at this time, and they were just...
I mean, yeah, we were just
straight cash.
To get to the topic a little more, So the Amiga was $3,000, right? Mm-hmm. You could get an S for what, 200 or something, or a Master System or whatever. So the types of games were quite different. I think because the barrier to entry was so much higher on an Amiga, which was a PC basically. Mm-hmm. We're getting different types of games, I think, as a result, because you had a lot of, there was a lot of RPGs and a lot of more involved type games. There weren't a lot of platformers really on a lot of these PCs, I think. Maybe on the ZX Spectrum, because that, I feel like everything was ported to that, but I don't know. What do you think about that? Anyone?
There's two things as well, I would say, that I think are really important up to the boundary of this discussion. And those two things are, hear me out on this, the mouse and the internet.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Right. And I'll tell you why they're both big. The mouse did not exist with the Spectrum, the Commodore 64, and the Amstrad. That no one had that. The mouse did come into play with the Amiga, but still was a bit meh. The reason I think that's quite important as well is I think a lot of people like myself, the concept of a game pad really started to change the dynamic of how you were playing. I hated playing games with keys. The whole concept ZXQA, get out, not interested. Give me a control pad, happy days. That was a real big difference. The internet, which we kind of have to touch on both sides of this topic, is you were bound to something that was the same. This will become more important in the second part of this. So what it led you to for a PC, if you've got a mouse and you are playing one player, it's strategy type games, point and click type games. So point and click games, that the kind of stuff that you got out of Lucas,
all those sorts of things.
Sierra was another one with a lot of those. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely huge. So it kind of played to its strengths. I think that was a really different thing. And those are two different things. So that peripheral was a big difference. I mean, think about when they tried to introduce a mouse to Mario Paint.
Yeah, the Super Nintendo.
It was garbage.
Fly Swatting.
Fly Swatting.
That's what that was for.
Okay, Lance, what was your first experience with PC gaming? Like, how far back? Where did you start?
Man, I want to say very early 90s, like late 80s. It wasn't really a game. It was like this, I guess you can call it a game. It was like programming. And I mean, I looked at it as a game. It was like, I had this book. It was like, God, I don't know, thicker than two Bibles. And it was like, literally the whole thing was for me to program a talking house. So I had to follow these lines of code, just like, because that's how it's like kind of teaching you programming. And
right. What language was it? Was it like QBasic or something, or Pascal, or do you even remember?
I don't remember, man. It was like, because literally everything was like in a keyboard and you hooked it up to like your regular television at home and, through like a coax cable and all that nonsense. And it was just like, so it was like, oh, at the end of this, the house should like say a few things and whatnot. So that's like, that was my very, very early thing. I don't even know if they even make that, or if it had a name or anything like that.
But okay,
that's like one of my earliest introductions to like.
So this literally hooked up to a TV set. This computer that you had.
Yeah, it was like it was just literally everything was like in this really massive looking keyboard. It was like mechanical, and you just sit there. And I didn't know how to type. I was like, well, I'm just gonna. It took me like half a day just trying to figure that out.
So this wasn't something running DOS or Windows or anything?
No, it's like you had to like do everything from command line. It was just ridiculous. I had no freaking clue about like, it was like, well, I don't know what this is, but I was having fun. And it was like, I mean, I didn't get the house to talk. So it moved, but there was no audio. It was just like, well, I don't know what to do with this.
And so I'm assuming you were into console, you were into video games around that time or before that time too, right? Like console games.
Yeah, I had, let me see, I had like a Game Boy, when did the first Game Boy come out?
Like 89.
Yeah, around that time I had that Game Boy, so I was like, I just destroyed that thing. Hours on end, just like, because it was like the best thing ever. And I think
Game Boy was hot.
Yeah, I was definitely all about that. It's like, and I think right after that, I think my first home console was like TurboGrafx 16. It wasn't even a Nintendo.
Oh my God, really?
Yeah.
You're one of those guys. that's what I like to call,
the 16.
That's what I call the dirty hippie console now, because everybody wants it. It's like all these millennials want the, and the, and the price has shot through the roof because of it, you know?
It was expensive then. It's still expensive now.
It's even more expensive now. It's crazy.
Yeah. My cousin had one and he was like, you want it? Because I think he was upgraded into like the NES or something. Like, he was doing something different.
You mean downgrading to the NES? The TurboGrafx was, well, technically
he,
better.
He called it upgraded. I was like,
okay. It's got Mario 3, man. That's an upgrade.
Right.
So I was like, yeah, I'll take this thing. And I was like, I think I had like 3 games tops because it was, I was so poor. I was like, I was a kid. So I was like, I had him.
Yeah.
He gave me that with like his 3 games and whatnot. It was something about, I think you were like a knight and you have to like upgrade over time. It kind of reminded me of Altered Beast, that sort of thing.
Like a Ghosts and Goblins game or something, maybe? Or
Golden Axe? Was that on the TurboGrafx?
No, I think that was a Sega. Yeah. It was Genesis, I think.
This one was like, it was some Japanese game, and you slowly turn into a Gundam or something. It looked like a Gundam, but it wasn't.
I don't know what that is.
Yeah,
I somebody knows.
I couldn't. I'm sure somebody...
I'm not familiar with that library on the TurboGrafx. Yeah,
I don't either.
I don't think a lot of people are just like at this point.
You should be, Mark. That's like the SHMUP... system, man. At least retro console. It's so
I know everyone's all about that era, but I'm more into like the Saturn.
Yeah, you're
era.
the newer Saturn. Stuff.
Yeah.
I'm not all about them TurboGrafx.
Yeah, TurboGrafx.
Yeah, I think like years after that, then when I got my first computer, which was like mid '90s, it couldn't run shit, but it was like. It didn't stop me from like just hooking up a bunch of crap to it. Just like, yeah, I'm gonna run the submarine simulator. That's like literally moved about 5 frames per second.
I was gonna say, yeah, probably three or four frames per second or something. Yeah,
it was so terrible. I held on to that game until I got my first Alienware. You know,
really?
And I was like, it must run now. But then again, it was so damn old. It was like, sorry, it's not going to happen.
Well, nice thing about with older, especially with DOS and some of those older PCs, is there were games that would run if you had a 286 or a 486. Yeah. There was different levels, levels of games that could run. You know, I remember that because my first PC was probably, I think it was a 286, which was garbage. You know, and this was like maybe 1990, probably around the same time you had yours, and I remember playing shareware games, you know, the games they give you, like I think Wolfenstein 3D would give you like the first level to play through, and I'd play through that, and on the 286 it was like, you know, juk, just really slow, you know, and I just went up from there. So it's similar. What about you, Mark? What was your you know, we all obviously game on the PC now in one form or another, but what about you, Mark? How did you start on computers? You're a bit younger than the rest of us, but I'm curious.
That's true, but I've got some stories for you guys, because I was a technology baby. So I was literally when I was like 3 years old playing on computers and stuff.
Oh my God.
So actually the first gaming platform I played on was not Windows. It was an Apple II. I had an Apple II and I actually loved that thing.
Okay. The 27-year-old guy here, maybe you're 28 now, I don't know. But you started on Apple II.
On an Apple II, because remember, I'm in Idaho, so everything goes back 10 years. Everything is like 10 years behind the rest of the world. So, yeah. So it's 91. I'm on an Apple II.
Okay.
Or 94, I guess it would have been.
Yeah.
Yeah, so my mom had an Apple II from work, and she brought it home. She's like, bam, here's an Apple II for you.
Or please tell me you played Oregon Trail on there, because that was always on the Apple II, I feel like.
Yep, I played Oregon Trail. I played Chutes and Ladders. I think there was like a really rudimentary platformer on there. I remember playing it with the keyboard and everything. And then we got a Super Nintendo. I was like, all right, see you, Apple II. Like, these days are done. So the Apple II, I still typed up little stories on there and stuff, but I almost never played games on it after that. However, my journey was not over, because in fourth grade, I had a friend. He was like the cool kid in class. He's like, he had like the 90s bowl cut. He wore like a necklace, you know, all the stuff. Anyway, he went over to his house, and his dad was into computers, and he had Windows 98, and he had StarCraft. and I was blown away. I was like, oh my God, this is the best game ever made. I want to play this. So I got to, you know, I begged my parents for literally 2 years, like, get me a computer. So I finally got one. And of course, my parents have no, to this day even, they have no idea how technology works. They have no idea about computers. All that is way over their head. Like, even now, they can barely run email. It's a struggle. So I got a computer, Windows 98, and I was able to get StarCraft to run on it. But it took me like 4 days to get it to run because I had no adult supervision on how to get this shit to work. So I was like,
hey, just, it was the same for me, man. My parents didn't know anything about computers.
Yeah, it took me seriously 4 days to install StarCraft just by like reading the box. And, you know, when I got it running.
This is Windows 98, man. It shouldn't have been that difficult. You know, I mean, I'm sure me and Justin probably were typing our way through DOS, you know. And
I was like eight, though. I was like an 8 year old. So once I got that, I felt like the smartest person on earth. I got this running. So I finally got StarCraft running, and then I figured out how to get on Battle.net and lag the crap out of adults with my like horrible dial-up connection. I thought was like the best player ever, just typing in little kid things into the chat.
See,
you know?
Here's a perfect example how we can compare consoles to PC. So StarCraft is a decidedly PC game. It's a real-time strategy game, right? So
made for
Justin
PC.
Was saying mouse, right? But did they make a StarCraft 64 on Nintendo 64?
Yeah, they did.
Okay, but it was totally different, right? It was like, or was it actually?
It was actually StarCraft 64, but I actually have it still. But controlling that thing with an N64 controller, Blizzard was clever and they were cool back in the day, but they still could not quite pull it off. So, yeah, it's kind of an amazing port, but it's not a fun port to play, I guess.
There you go. So that's a perfect example of the differences there. And maybe we could take it back to that and take it back to you, Justin, about talking about what's the difference. I want to just, before we move on to the more modern topic, I want to get how things were different in the 80s and 90s with, you know, PC games versus console games. And we've touched on it a little bit, but why? What are the specific differences? You said the mouse, right? The maybe the hardware, maybe because computers were designed to run other things other than games. So maybe it was more, I don't know if it was more difficult to design games on, that would work on these microcomputers or in DOS as opposed to a console, which is specialized just for games.
Justin? Well, I think some of it as well is to do with primary function. So, you know, and I'm kind of thinking about how did I feel when I was growing up? You know, Nintendo had all of this wonderful first party software. This was a box that was built to do one job, and it was supported to do one job, and you knew what you were going to get and more. And that was fascinating. Whereas the PC wasn't. Now, I mean, I should probably declare I'm not a PC gamer. I don't play games on PC today. I don't.
Okay.
At all.
That's right. You're 100% console guy.
I'm console and retro arcade. I'll put me in front of an arcade cabinet. Yeah, I'm cool. put me in front of consoles and I'm good. It's not that I refuse to. It's not like some kind of stigma. I just, it doesn't attract me and it never really did. I think they were the differences, you know, sort of back then there was more simplicity to some of the games, and those were the things that got me, the, you know, be it a racing game or a platform game or whatever lent itself to that. And those kind of PC gaming just didn't grab me. I felt that I had something that was geared to games, and also there was this kind of we talked about the console wars before. I think there was a very much a, if you were a proper gamer, you didn't play on PC. That's just stupid. You know, I think that's the thing.
PC,
you know,
was the super uber nerd thing to do back then, I think.
You were basically hardcore if you played on PC.
The consoles were more mainstream, you know. And I think whereas today, and we'll get into this more a little later, today the line's blurring, and I think I don't know what the numbers are, but there's probably just as many people playing on PC than there is consoles, I would imagine, at this point.
Oh, it's definitely shifting, yeah.
Yeah,
I've got plenty to say on that as well. But you know, to me, the cool kids you had the hyper nerdy kids, if usually from the richer backgrounds again, that had the PC. But to me, the cool kid didn't have PC. No, the cool kid was that one kid you could find who had a Neo Geo. That,
oh, wow. God, yeah, that was. I don't think I knew anyone in school that had a Neo Geo, man.
No, or like in Idaho, it was a Sony PlayStation. Like, yeah. Like the PlayStation was like the Neo Geo of Idaho. Like, if you had a PlayStation, it's like, oh shit, he's got a PlayStation, dude.
The PlayStation was our friend. I think the PlayStation was a bit pricey when it first came out too. I don't know.
Well, it's because too, like, remember, Idaho people are very like stuck in the past. I'm not kidding. Most of my friends and their parents refused to get a PlayStation because it had CDs.
Oh wow.
And like everyone was all against CDs back then. They're like, those suck. Yep. Those get scratched. They don't work. You know, CDs blow. No one bought a PlayStation except that one like trendy kid whose parents knew how to use a CD. And right. So he had a PlayStation. We all went over to his house like, oh snap, he's got a PlayStation. So
that is a, yeah. Okay. I guess, demographics, where you live, how rich or poor you are, all those things factor into, what you played on. And maybe it also factors into, the design of the games. So like I was saying, I think PC games, for me anyway, like when I got into PC gaming was the early 90s. I never stopped playing on console, but I just kind of also started playing on PC. It's like, if I wanted my RPG, my really, in-depth RPG or strategy, type games, I'd go to PC, you know.
That's where they were.
That's where they were, you know. Those
or FPS games.
Yeah, even first person shooters, even. Yeah, until Halo came out, you know.
Yeah,
it's like first person shooters, it was on the PC. But then if I wanted platformers or, you know, Mario or Zelda or whatever, I would just go to, you know, play on console, you know, which was a different type of gaming altogether, you know. Or action, I feel like action games, running guns and shmups, even console is where it's at. At least it was, you know, for those type of games. So, yeah.
There's another common denominator there, which is why I brought up the internet earlier, and I think I need to kind of shift it into the second part of what we talk about, is multiplayer. So we've talked about that lot, you know, when we talked about Toe Gemino, that's why we're here.
Yep.
I you know, grew up playing games with my brother. A lot of people grew up playing games with their sibling. The PC in that era did not lend itself to playing multiple player games.
It really didn't.
Unless you were super swag and you had land.
If you had two wonky Gravis pads that you could plug in and hope that they worked, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
Or if you did the fun, I did this with my brother once, you split the keyboard, like, you're on the left side of the keyboard, they're on the right. Remember doing that?
Yep.
Yeah, that's a whole horrible way to know.
Yeah. Horrible.
But you could screw them up, though. You'd be like, bam! Oh!
I don't miss the split keyboard. But continue, Justin.
No, so that's the thing. You know, you go all the way back, even to the Nintendo and the Sega Master System. Two pads, two sockets, away you go. It was kind of built for that.
Or even four sometimes.
Well, yeah, I mean, I vividly remember seeing one of the first multi-taps come out and thinking this is one of the most amazing inventions since the telephone.
Super off-road on NES, you could play four players with a multi-tap.
I mean, one of my favorite games of all time is Super Off-Road. I think that has a lot to answer for, because, like I say, you grew up with your sibling, typically both of you, unless you... Well, often I guess if it was brother sister at the time, probably it had less of an appeal to girls. I would say probably growing up in the '80s and
back
90s.
Then it did. Yeah, I guess.
Except Sonic, not Sonic.
Yeah, right. No, that's true.
My sister loved Sonic.
Every girl. The only game they played was Sonic.
You're right, man.
Yeah,
she played Echo. She played Echo the Dolphin, and she played Sonic.
But you know, they so many memories that I have growing up are playing those games with Soren. And it just would not have worked on a PC. It just wouldn't have worked.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. So, okay, I think on
hold
that
on, way, we're not getting out of this topic because I
all right.
I thought about this all day and have a story.
Okay,
for you guys.
Mark, go ahead.
not getting out of this topic yet. Okay, so I think the huge problem with PC gaming, like I said, I had no adult supervision as far as how to get this shit to run, how to get it to work. All my friends were like, had no clue. I was flying solo. When you go to stores for help, you know, the people at the counters mostly didn't know how to help you. And so the problem with PC gaming that I ran into back in the day was there was no standardization between games and releases, and it was really hard to figure out if this game would run on your PC or not.
That's a good
So one year I saved up all my Christmas money for this strategy game that was a World War II strategy game. I was so hyped for this game. I can't tell you how excited I was. And so I got it, I brought it home, I put it in my computer, and my PC's like, nah, bro, I won't run this shit. I was like, I couldn't believe it.
This was
I
was like, Windows what? Why not? 98? This is your Windows 98 machine?
Yeah, it's my Windows 98. It would only run on like an old, a newer OS or something, or the graphics card wasn't good enough. Yeah. Anyway, so I had no idea what to do. I went to my parents and like, it won't run the game. It won't run the game. They're like, did you put it in there? I'm like, yeah, I put it in there. Like, we don't know what. And I called like Circuit City, if you guys remember that. I was like, it won't run the game. And they're like, here, buy this. So I went there. I spent the rest of my Christmas money on a RAM stick. They're like, buy this RAM stick. So I take the RAM stick. I don't know what to do with it. I just shove it in my computer. I'm like, okay, will it run now? And it's like, nah, bro, I'm not going to run. So I spent like $150 on this game that I could never get to run for years. And I'm not super
proud of this.
It was a World War II strategy game. To this day, I can't remember what it was. But like, I sat in my room again. I was like 9 or 10, and I cried. I was like, I can't believe this. It broke my heart. So like, after then, I was kind of like, I'm kind of done with PC gaming for a while, just because. But then Warcraft 3 came out, and I got hooked again. But yeah, I think that was the huge, huge issue I ran into every single time I tried to play on PC as a kid. Is you never knew if your PC could run the games. I was always behind the times with my hardware, because my parents weren't going to pony up all these new graphics cards and stuff. And
it was, it was the same with me.
It was such a struggle to play games on the PC.
Yeah,
I don't think I don't think I have a story quite like that, but I do, but there definitely was times where, particularly when I had the 286, where I was installing games like the original Wing Commander, I installed on there, and it, like Lance was saying earlier, it ran at like five frames a second, you know. It just was horrible. But then once I got a new computer, a 486, then it ran great, you know. But yeah, that's I think anyone who was nerdy enough like us, I guess, to play PC games back in the day have had that experience where this damn thing won't work, you know. Dude, I'll tell you what, to this day, AAA games I will play on my PS4 Pro, because it's just less janky than playing on the PC. Like, I can hit a button on my PS4, it fires right up. I select, like, Outer Worlds, I'll select it, and I'm in the game in 2 seconds, right where I was before. On the PC, I'd have to load the game up, wait, you know, then load my save, then go back to where I was. You know, it's not as easy as it is on a console. So anyway, we'll get into that in the next segment. So we'll take a quick break, and when we be right back, we will talk modern PC gaming and console gaming. Be right back. We're back, and we are here to talk modern consoles. I guess we'll talk post 2000 now. And if we feel that PCs are finally catching up to consoles, which I think we can all agree they basically are, but the line's been starting to blur for a while, including similarities in operating systems, hardware, you name it. So
upgrades.
Yeah, upgrades. So how close are we now to PCs, just consoles and PCs basically merging? Lance, you wanted to discuss this. This was your topic. So why don't you start us off and tell us what you think?
So are you talking about, like, you want to know current console or like the future ones that Sony and
We can do that. However you want to approach it, Manny, if you want to talk to, if you want to start with PS5 and the new Xbox, by all means,
go for it. Xbox. What's the name? Xbox Series X?
Xbox, I don't know, man. Extra Box X.
Extra Box.
Microsoft's triple Xbox.
Yeah.
I shouldn't speak too loud. I work in the same building as them. So let's start off about the Xbox, the next generation, what we know so far, because so far, you know, both companies are kind of like just dripping out, you know, things here and there, and people are like scouring like patent offices, like to see what the release is, like, ooh, what's next, you know. But usually when you see a patent, it doesn't necessarily mean that's going to be the next console. Yeah. It's just something they patent. There's really nothing to do one way or the other. However, Xbox announced their Xbox Series X, which should be dropping, I think, this year. They say holiday, so around, you know, November, like October, November, that sort of thing. Probably November. So based on the specs that they're pointing out right now, they're saying that it's going to have an AMD Zen 2 base processor, which is like an 8-core, it's an 8-core processor, which I don't think any other consoles ever really had that before.
I don't think so, no.
Which is, you know,
all them cores.
Standard, you know, it's kind of like your entry level for, like, hell, a basic laptop at this point. Yeah. You know, graphics is going to be AMD based. And then you see they're saying 16 gigs of RAM, DDR6, which is, you know, okay, cool. It's like, yeah, you know, but who knows if you're actually going to use most of
that. That's a lot of RAM for a console.
Yeah, for sure. All the stuff I'm saying is kind of like base gaming PC. If you were to like build one on a budget, I would say $500 to $800. And now the thing that people got really, really excited about is the storage. NVMe's SSD drive, so solid state hard drives, which are they're promising, or they're saying that, oh, we heard read speeds of 2 gigs per second. Now, I should say, they're saying that, oh, that should cut down on load times, it should load your environments quicker and stuff like that. The problem with NVMe, like, don't get me wrong, they're really fast. I have them in every freaking computer that I have in my house. But I usually just put the OS on there. I don't run my games off of it.
Tend to be a lot smaller, you know.
Right, they're smaller.
Expensive.
They're expensive.
All the monies.
Like, you know, you probably spend most of your budget on one of those things than buying a damn computer. But they heat up very quickly. And if this console, based on the console that they really, like the picture of it, like what they showed off, to me, it looks like an eGPU slap with a hard drive slapped into it. So if you don't know what eGPU is, they're like external enclosures for graphics cards that if your particular computer doesn't have enough graphics horsepower to like either play a game or do some sort of work in 3D rendering, that sort of thing, you can buy these smaller enclosures, buy whatever graphics card you want, and like slap it in there for like maybe a third of the price of buying an entire computer to do that type of work. And that's, you know, that's what a lot of people are really excited about, that stuff. And it's like, well, don't get too excited, because if we've known anything about Microsoft and their, when it comes to cooling their systems, they've never been really good at that. It's like, you know, you've always had to buy these like peripherals to actually get that done, or you know, they just kind of like find ways to upsell you.
Just remember,
have you seen the old school mod on the 360 where people used to cut holes in the side of their 360 to pull it?
The red ring of death, man. You know how many? I think my brother went through 3 or 4 Xbox 360s at once. It's like, it's crazy, man. How many?
Right.
Yeah, you got to get the latest, the last one.
Wait for like a few iterations of these things to come out before. I would say don't buy any of these new generation stuff first day, because, you know, people like to marathon game a lot, especially with games like, you know, Fortnite and a lot of these arena games where people just play for hours and hours and hours. And it's like, you know, these consoles, the closer they're getting to PC, one thing that these companies are not really doing is not doing well is come to cooling. It's like, you need to keep that thing running for a very long time and not mess up your game or whatever. And now SSDs are crazy expensive. They don't say how big this SSD drive is going to be, which is curious. You know, and on top of that, they're promising video output up to 8K. And
probably means it'll like, you can watch a movie in 8K, but do you honestly think that any game is going to run in 8K on the new Xbox?
No,
I don't think so. And if it did, it would be at 5 frames a second.
Right. I have a feeling, like, maybe at the end of the console life, you might get that, because that's usually how it goes. It's like because most developers
up at 8K.
Yeah. Zach. Yeah,
that's what you're getting.
Pretty much. And it's like, you know, everything else, they're saying that, you know, they're going to have these RTX, ray tracing stuff. If you don't know, if you're not familiar with ray tracing, if you're not like a 3D modeler or anything like that, then you probably never heard of it, but in the computer world, where especially with now NVIDIA RTX graphics cards, they claim that we can give you, you know, kind of like uncanny valley graphics, meaning you can't, it looks so damn real and shiny. Everything is like, but the problem with it, with that is you can run very, very high resolution, but slower frame rates. So you're not going to be like going up, nothing above 30 frame rates, like 30 FPS. You're not really going to go higher than that. If you
deal breaker for Mark, deal breaker.
Yeah. It's like,
oh yeah.
So if you're like, if you want to go 60 and above 120, some people
120
are
120 boys.
Yeah. Wow. Like you need to do 1080. You're good. Boom. You don't have to worry about anything. And honestly, I would advise a lot of people just to stick to 1080 at this point, you know?
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, on the side of PlayStation now, we don't know what the hell they're putting out, because all they did was reveal a logo. And I was like, cool. Okay. It's like, you know, I mean, there are other rumors of like saying that it would also have an 8-core AMD chipset, and it would also have an SSD storage as well. And, you know, the big part, backwards compatibility with PS4 games and PSVR games and stuff like that, or the hardware.
That'll be all nice. Those little
plastic toys that everybody's been buying for them. So, And so far, you know, no word on price or very specific specs. And I'm willing to bet that these things will probably cost whatever the last generation, the highest mark was for those. I would say it would probably cost $100 more.
So like Xbox Scorpio type price or PS4 Pro? Yeah,
I would say in that Pro area. I have a feeling that, I mean, you know, Microsoft has always said that they will be releasing multiple tiered different type of Xboxes. And I feel like to get this 8K SSD for, you know, whatever, it's probably going to be that top tiered Pro version of that. Whereas Sony may not do that at launch. They probably just release like, well, here are all the power that we can muster into this console. And it might be, you know, a little bit cheaper than the Xbox that what Microsoft is trying to put out there. That's my prediction.
I can see 4K 60 running, definitely.
Oh, yeah,
like sure. my PS4 Pro, I mean, it runs 4K. I think most of the games are probably 4K 30. You know, I mean, Horizon Zero Dawn ran 4K 30 and it was just gorgeous, you know, just absolutely gorgeous game. Outer Worlds runs fine. No Man's Sky. It's a lot of games I've played in 4K. Even Doom 2016 ran really well in 4K on the PS4 Pro, you know. So I would think that the next gen PS5 and Xbox would run 4K 60, no problem. But 8K, man, I don't know. That's, you're talking.
Listen, that's just marketing.
Yeah.
It's just throwing out a bunch of big numbers.
4K on the PS4. That really turned out, right?
Well, 4K
the PS4 can barely run stuff.
Yeah, right. And it's the base PS4, yeah.
Yeah, I'm talking about the original.
But even the Pro struggles in 4K sometimes, you know. It's not you definitely see some issues, you know, here and there with it. It ain't perfect, you know. It definitely struggles a bit. But I mean, as far as it's funny because I've switched back and forth. No Man's Sky, I've played that a lot on PC and PS4 on my PS4 Pro. And I've switched back and forth, both in 4K. It's like, I mean, you know, they look identical. You know, like there's no difference really between the two, which is a good, I guess, examination here of what the topic is, which is PC console gaming merging? And just to use that game as an example, it's identical on both in terms of the way it looks and played for the most part.
Right.
So yeah, it's like, you know.
I would argue that it already merged with the PS4. I feel like that was the leap from we're consoles to now we're PCs.
You're basically right, because doesn't the PS4 uses an x86 processor, correct?
Yeah, and you'll also notice that the PS5 can run the PS4 backwards compatibly, or will most likely just run it fine.
Right, you're right.
The PS3 was like this convoluted, weird cell beast.
Processor. Yeah.
That even today you can't freaking emulate well, and
so it's because of the cell processor.
It's like dedicated hardware.
But the cell processor was so powerful that they were linking PS3s together to make supercomputers at one point. If I recall,
folding at home.
Yeah,
I think it was called.
PS3 is a crazy console because they basically said, screw GPU, let's do it all through the CPU.
Yeah, you're right, basically.
They had to learn their lesson.
And it was a custom chip that no one knew how to program for, and that's why it was so expensive. You remember the PS3 when it came out, it was like, how much was it, like $600?
Yes, it was,
how much it was.
During an economic recession, too.
No right, yeah, the mid, shit. The mid-2000s. Yeah, that was crazy. It's why the 360 dominated that generation, but...
All my friends got 360s for that reason. They're like, we can't afford a PS3, so...
I got a PS3.
Yeah. And I would say that one of my biggest fears for... because it's been on that march where I believe when I first got the Xbox 360 and I was like, I didn't have, you know, a little game pad you can buy, attach it to the bottom of your controller that was like a keyboard.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, I'm frustrated because I want to type. So I had this old USB keyboard laying around. I was like, well, this has a USB port. Plug it in. Guess what? It works. It was just like, I was like, oh. And it's like, no one was talking about that. It's like, you can just take a peripheral that is more or less for a PC and just, or a Mac, and it's like, you throw it in and the shit just works. And I was just like, oh, okay. And then, I mean, you couldn't do it on PS3, but PS4 you can. And then, you know, they're just like kind of marching along this like really small little in, like upgrades to that. And I think like right now, what game allows you to get mods now? I think it was one of the
Fallout. One of the Bethesda games, right?
Yeah, like you can.
Because then they wanted to sell them. I remember that.
Right? Yeah.
Skyrim, you know? They like, you can have mods, so we can sell you the mods, but
you know, you can buy mods. You know. So it was like all this things they've been trying to like drop in here and there to try to inch their way into that market. Whereas, you know, I don't think they would ever actually. You know, right now, I don't think consoles, even the next gen consoles, are not going to be catching up to even mid-range like tier PC bills, because by that time that comes around, the generation of equipment or just like the parts would just be completely outdated. Different.
Outdated.
And it's like and one of my biggest fears is that it will start to outprice a lot of folks, because one of the biggest reasons why a lot of folks who like I love console because they are cheaper to get. And then the second one down from that is like, well, it's easy to run the games. I don't have to worry about all this extra shit, like, you know, drivers updates and yada,
your RAM stick from Circuit City.
Your NVIDIA drivers are out of date. Like mine constantly are constantly, man.
Yeah. Every time I boot up the computer.
Every time. It's out of date right now. I can see the little exclamation point next to the icon, dude. It's like.
And I would say for sure, like I definitely have both consoles and PCs, and I wish I could. I definitely want to play more on console, but you know, I'd rather play with my friends and stuff like that. And most of them, they play at odd hours, which I'm not up for. So, and I would say I've had a lot more fun with consoles over the years, just because of this ease and accessibility and just you know, you plug and you play and it works. You know, if it breaks, there's a way to fix it. You know, like you send it in, fix it, it comes back in a week or so, you're good to go again. You know, and it's like definitely that whole community that's around it. And it's like, but with the new stuff coming out, I don't know exactly, like it's, they're getting closer, I would say, more on the low end side of things. But I don't know if a lot of console gamers care. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't think they, you know. And then on top of that, too, the peripherals you would have to buy to even see that 8K resolution or that 4K can sometimes it's more expensive than the console.
The TV, man. 8K TVs are how much now? Like over $10,000 probably?
And they're probably horrible to play on, too. Yeah. But the lag is just out of control.
Right. Then most of the time, most televisions are like most high-end, you know, LEDs, or not even LED, QLEDs or OLEDs and stuff like that. They're not built for gaming. Like they didn't have that in mind at all. It's not until like, I would say in the last 6 months or so, manufacturers are starting to release televisions that have like G-Sync or, you know, or V-Sync, you know, that these sort of like things to like help out better with gaming and stuff like that for consoles or PCs. You know, it's like depends on what you want to hook up to it. So it's like they're getting there, but for the most part, I was informed. I said, well, get yourself a really nice gaming monitor, because that will look good if you're a PC gamer or you're a console gamer, because the monitor itself with the high refresh rate will take advantage of those frames that you're trying to get, you know, overall, yeah, especially for like competitive gamers.
There's also the law of diminishing returns. Like, I mentioned Horizon Zero Dawn earlier. That game came out in 2017, and it's in 4K. It is probably the most gorgeous game I've ever seen. Like, it's not the most realistic looking game, but it's like, you know, if you're going to play it on PC versus console, the difference is so minute at this point. It's like, even a lower end, like you were saying, even if the console is equivalent to a lower end PC, you're still going to get really nice results graphics wise, you know.
Oh, yeah.
It's still going to look amazing, you know? So it's really just merging together now. There's really not a lot of difference, I think, except for perhaps, like you said, ease of use. And in my case, I like playing on my PS4 because it's just easier. I can sit down and be in the game in about 5 seconds as opposed to the PC, which would take me, you know, probably 5 minutes to get into everything.
Update,
you know?
Login.
Yeah, dude, exactly. All that shit. You know?
Yeah, you know, I think, especially with this upcoming generation, I almost feel like the Xbox Triple X, Next X, your Xbox. I feel like Microsoft has basically bowed out of making consoles, and really the next Xbox is more along the lines of something like a Steam machine, because they're not really trying to do anything. If you're thinking of from a console maker's perspective, none of their decisions make any sense. They're releasing three different versions. That makes no sense for consoles. They told you right out the gate, we're not going to have any exclusives. You can play this on anything.
Yeah.
And then they're also doing everything they can to cross play with PC, and they're even working with Nintendo. So I think Xbox is slowly kind of just exiting the console sphere, because they got Windows, man. They don't need the console sphere. They're the kings of PCs anyway.
All right, Justin raised his hand. All right, yeah. Justin, you've been silent this round, so go ahead.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I've been silent for a reason, because I'm about to blow this wide open.
Let's do it.
Wide open. Okay, so I'm going to give you two things really important. One, here's my statement for you right now. This is the last generation of consoles across the board.
I
agree.
They're done.
You might be right, yeah.
They are done.
Or at least as we know the console anyway.
I think the last console is the PS5. I wouldn't even count the Xbox.
So they're done, and I'm going to explain to you why. Right. Also, if we had four people sitting here talking now who were 14 years old, they would be saying something very different to you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right?
iPad, baby.
Yes.
No, not just the iPad. Hear me out. So my
kids love the iPad.
my kids, a bit younger than that, my friends' kids, this go a bit older, the way that they interact and they want to game is nothing like what we want.
Not even close.
It's a culture shift that is wild. So they're looking for more instant gratification, but what they're also looking for, they all love play. I learned of Discord because of my mate's kids. They love having 300 tabs open. They have, some of my mates' kids have FaceTime open on their phone whilst they're doing something on the PC, and it's all about comms, internet, blah, 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 blah. It's all over the bloody place.
Multitaskers.
They do not want to sit down with a control pad, okay? Yeah. So two things. There's the consumer, which is them, and they're growing up, and we're just getting old and dying because we're old. but here's the first shout of the new year for boring business, Justin. Here he is. Hi to all the listeners who've missed me. So if you look at Microsoft and Nintendo partnering up, that was one of the final death nails in the coffin of consoles. Microsoft don't give two shiny shits about selling Xboxes.
No, not at all.
It is not a primary business. If you take the software, and when I say the software, I'm talking about the GUI, the presentation,
the services,
it already
sits
on...
Like the operating system, right? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. Well, Well, guess what? That already sits on 95% of the machines on the planet. Yeah. And comes with everything you already buy. So you're already buying a gaming machine by taking a machine that is doing something else anyway. And now they're already of a certain capability, et cetera, et cetera. Because these manufacturers don't have what they had in the first part of the show, which is first party real kind of catalogs or alliances. Take the two big boys at the moment. Well, say two big boys. Park Nintendo for a second. Sony and Microsoft have fuck all. I should try to keep my swearing to a minimum.
I do want to say though, I think the person whose future looks the most bleak is Sony, because Microsoft owns Windows. They own it. Nintendo has their software. They have their games. They could just become a game studio.
Right.
Sony's the one that's like, shit, because they're just hardware.
What are they going to do?
Listen. Speaking of Sony, this was just announced, I think this week or last week, is that Sony's going to start releasing their exclusives on PC. Did you hear about that? Horizon Zero Dawn is going to be on PC. That was the first announcement. Yes.
They might need to look into becoming, like, not now, but in the future, some kind of software company.
I think it's going to become about branding. Xbox will be a brand, publisher or something. And PlayStation will be a brand, instead of just a console. I think it's going to be more about branding. Same with Nintendo, maybe. But Nintendo's in a unique position, though. They're
a game studio, though. So they can always just go full software if they need to.
I think, Xbox is going to take on somewhat of that. Not streaming, like a Netflixy type brand. They are going to have that.
Steam.
Steam is a much better example. That kind of, this is where they're going to go. Nintendo know that as amazing as their hardware is from a conceptual point of view, not obviously the grunt that's in the box.
Right.
The Switch is ergonomically a masterpiece. It is. It just is. But they have that back catalogue. They have that first party gaming. What they don't have is the reach that Microsoft has by being operating system on, 90%+ of the world's platform. Yeah. But Microsoft also have a huge cloud platform as well. And despite the fact that I constantly jab at Stadia, one of the things we've often talked about is there is a potential for a future where cloud gaming and streaming becomes in a different way. And let's not go down that avenue. A thing, and Microsoft have that. What did Microsoft not have? They don't have a first party catalog. Oh, well, they do. Those guys over at Nintendo, that becomes the future of gaming to me. Consoles are dead beyond the next generation. And that's why.
Except maybe the Switch, which they can just keep iterating on.
Well, that's it. I think the Switch is a handheld, though. Like, that makes a huge difference in its success. Yeah. I think if they.
It's also why it's so successful and already.
Yeah. Because that's the only reason I own a Switch, and most people I know either buy it because they want Nintendo games, so they're either Nintendo fans, or they're like me and they love handhelds. So it gets those two niches together, which is good. But I don't think if they released like a boxed console or whatever, like a traditional console, it would have been as successful as
no way
the handheld hybrid thing they went with.
Yeah, go ahead, Lance. You had something to say.
Speaking of like handheld stuff, have you guys seen the this year's CES Alienware released this concept?
Yeah, I saw it. Which, looks pretty sick. Yes. Not gonna lie.
Yeah, they won't say what the fuck is in it, but more or less, there is running full Windows, and you can just play PC games. And I think it's called the Concept UFO. If you look it up, it's portable gaming PC.
Yes. It's a Switch, basically, but for
it's a Switch on steroids.
Yeah, pretty much. And it's
with
like
Windows.
That and I completely agree, Mark. Right? Justin. Sorry. I agree with both of you. It's like, but just for sure, Justin. Like you mentioned something that I feel like definitely the future, which is, it's probably going to be in the cloud. It's probably like Microsoft does have xCloud, which I know it's in beta right now, and a friend of mine got into it and he says he loves it. Like he's just like, oh, it's the best thing ever. But he's a huge Microsoft fan. But it's like, and it's, I completely agree. It's like, I think this is it for these consoles. I think there's really nothing else where it's like, I've heard talks of like Microsoft saying that they want to get to a point where, I mean, you can buy some sort of hardware, but it's more or less like a server, like a hub. It's just something you just
like a piece. It's like the Microsoft branded PC.
Pretty much, yeah. And it just kind of like sits in your, you know, your closet somewhere, you know, or your room, wherever. It just kind of sits there and just serves you all these things. Like, it just streams everything to you. And it's like, and you don't have to, like, there's no moving parts. It's just kind of like, it just sits there. You don't think about it, but you can, like, pull up your iPad, your you know, your tablet, you know, whatever Android tablet you have, or your phone.
Stream to anything in your house, yeah.
Yeah, and it's just like, you walk around from, you know, room to room and whatnot, and it's like, and even the way things are all coming together, like, recently, me and my fiance, we purchased, we found a really sweet deal of, like, two 40-inch 4K televisions for literally less than $500. And we were like, okay, cool. We put it on there. I didn't even look. It was like, I was asking for the dumbest TV I can find. Nothing with all those extras.
Yeah.
But this is like the dumbest one they had. It was these Vizio TVs. I was like, oh, whatever. We're going to put them in the gaming room. I don't really care for anything like that. But the thing has built-in Chromecast and AirPlay. And I was like, the fuck? It was like, literally, my Xbox sees it, like, as this extra display and all this other extra stuff. And it's like, they're all starting to talk to each other where it's like, I literally don't need to be in the same room as the console. I can just play from anything. Yeah. And it's like,
I mean,
and then when you look at things like the iPad Pro, the specs on that thing is insane. It's like, I was like, it's not quite a laptop, but their iteration when it comes to, like, looking at games on it, because they released a game arcade, I think, last year. I think it was like $5 and you get like a couple hundred games or whatever.
Yeah.
And it's like, and I've dabbled around with it. It's like the
how is that anyway?
It's pretty fun. Like, if like the cool thing about it is that, one, all the games you can play offline, every single one. It's $5 a month, and then you get hundreds of games to pick from, and they're all high quality. Like, I can feel my iPad getting hot, like, playing some of these games. I have an older iPad, so it's like, you know, it's like, but it's they're fully featured. They run completely offline. You don't need to be online all the time. You don't have no ads. There's none of that crap. It just runs. And it's just like, this is probably what the future is going to look like. It's just like, you pay a subscription and you have this access to this library of games, you know. That might not be good news for game developers because, you know, part of their bread and butter is like their hardware. Like, you pay $60, $65 for this game. You have to go line up somewhere and yada yada and shipping costs and all this other stuff and whatnot. But it definitely opens up for way more games at a faster clip. We may not even get long-term games, like, you know, like long-running games, like where it's like you need 110 hours to finish X and stuff like that. Or there might be, but it would be DLCs. You know, if you want this next level.
No Witcher 3s then. Yeah, they're 174 hours.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I feel like that's actually the direction everyone's going, though, is like The Witcher 3, where they release this game, and then they just release DLC for it for years.
Skyrim, man. Skyrim's been going for almost 10 years now, you know?
Wow.
And it's insane. You know, they release it on everything imaginable, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's on the iPad.
Yeah, dude, it's on everything. It's on the Switch, on the iPad, on, you know, on your toilet, probably, if you wanted it to be, you know, your smart toilet.
I'm sure. Can it run Doom?
Exactly, yeah, Doom. Yeah, Doom on your smart toilet screen.
Yeah. Ugh. But, yeah, I completely agree with you guys in the sense that this is probably the last hurrah for these type of hardware. And everything is just about interconnected stuff and figuring out how to stream it right away and how fast we can get it, you know, just, you know, on.
Yeah.
For the most
part. Yeah. I already feel like that line has been kind of really blurred between, because I've been trying to figure out a reason to buy an Xbox X or whatever, you know, Xbox One X. I've been trying to give myself a reason to buy one of those since it came out. I still haven't been able to get myself to buy it because I can't justify what would it do for me that my PC doesn't, right? It doesn't really have anything to offer.
With the Xbox, there's really no reason. Like, at least
there's like nothing to
at
offer.
At least with PlayStation, there's a lot of exclusives, you know?
So I think that's kind of just the direction we're going is, I think Sony this generation is going to have to hustle their ass to get as many exclusives on their machine as possible. Microsoft don't give a damn. And then Nintendo will continue to make handheld stuff. And PC will just kind of take over.
Nintendo's all about exclusives too, you know? I mean, a lot of people just have the Switch because they love Nintendo games, you know?
That's true.
The beauty of the Switch is that all those PC, a lot of PC...
But that didn't work with the Wii U. I think the fact that the Switch...
Crap. At least I
no way, man. Wii U's badass, dude.
The hat now, it's horrible. It's a half-baked idea, I thought. All right, here, you wanted a conflict, Mark? Here we go.
Yeah, okay. So here's what I'm saying, though, is that... Okay, so the Wii U, again, did something different.
Yeah,
but
half-baked it.
But the sales were horrible for it, even though everyone sat around and said, this game, this console is full of amazing games, but it has a ton of amazing games on it.
Yeah, Star Fox Zero.
It just didn't, more than
that. Where you got to play like this, you know.
More than Star Fox Zero, though, it had a ton of amazing games. But with the Switch, they figured out the hardware side of things, and I think the handheld aspect of it was it. So I felt like if they had just released, you know, a regular console, I don't think it would be the success we're seeing today at all.
Well,
even though people love Nintendo games.
Well, okay.
Otherwise, everyone would have bought a Wii U if that
was. Here's the thing about the Wii U, and I had one for years, and
I have one sitting right next to me.
You know, I got rid of mine because I just hated it. But the reason I hated it was because the gamepad was huge. I couldn't leave the room, you know. The battery life on it was horrible. There was all these reasons why it was a half-baked idea, you know. But the Switch fixed all that because it was the same as the Wii U, except just better, you know, because you can actually take it anywhere you want, you know. And you drop it into the stand and it pops up on your TV. It's a brilliant design. It's what the Wii U wanted to be, but just couldn't because it wasn't there yet. You know?
That's what I'm saying, though, is that we can't... What I'm saying, though, is that... We can't just say, well, if Nintendo releases a console, people will buy it because it's Nintendo and people love their software, because the Wii U sort of proved that's not the case.
And the GameCube to GameCube sold.
Or the GameCube. Yeah, same thing. Like, that's not the case. It's not enough. There needs to be that hardware, too, which I think is why the Switch worked.
Justin?
We're going off-piste here, but I am absolutely convinced that the Wii U was a market tester for the Switch. I believe they knew where they wanted to go with the Switch. They weren't quite ready with where they wanted to go, and they wanted to see what the handheld element of something in hand felt like and what people's response was. It was almost like market research, and everybody came back and said the same. It would be really cool if I could take this more than 10 feet away from my television. And I think they used that as a piece of research with what they had from the Wii, which had many flaws as well. What they got from the Wii U, which, for the record, I love the Wii U, and then what they ended up producing was the masterpiece. I don't know what your problem with the Wii U is. Wii U is absolutely amazing.
No, it's not, dude. It's not.
Well, I agree, sort of. I feel like the Wii U was the first draft of the Switch, but I don't want to. I don't think Nintendo had the master plan right from the start, like, hey, this could work. I think they didn't know what the hell to do. They had all these kind of ideas that weren't fully formed with the Wii U.
With Mark on this.
And then at the end of the Wii U, they're like, wait a minute. Let's just make a handheld.
Yeah, make a handheld that you can drop into a dock. Boom.
It's like, they figured it out. Boy. But I feel like the Wii U was kind of like all these different ideas colliding. But I like it a lot.
I'm with Justin. I think someone was working at Nintendo. It's like, listen, this is what I've been talking about all along.
Yes.
Like, what the? Come on, guys.
Some young intern was like, listen, this is what we got to do. You know?
Okay. It's like, I'm telling you. It's like, whatever. Get out of here. It's
like, yeah. And then the Wii U fails, and they're like, okay, what was that idea you had, dude? Yeah. Okay. Well, I think we're pretty good there since we can close on the Wii U and, I don't know how we got on that, but that's good. It's great because the Wii U merged into a beautiful console. So anyway, the moral of that story is that we think that this is probably the last generation of consoles, at least traditional consoles, that we're going to see. You know. Mm. So before we go, Lance, why don't you tell us a little bit about what you do and your Gifted Sounds Podcast Network. Let us know where to find that and a little bit about it.
Yeah, cool. So Give the Sounds Network is a, well, more or less independent podcast network. We pretty much support anyone that like wants to do a podcast. We help you build one from whatever concept you have on a paper napkin to pushing out there your first episode. Provide a different, we do have some services behind that when it just comes to just production, where you can either, hire us in that sense if you want to, or if you want to join the network as, you have an existing podcast, you want to join the network and stuff like that, we can definitely have conversations around that and how we operate, help you get onto a bunch of different directories that's out there, like Spotify, Pandora. Well, yeah, Pandora is now adding podcasts. Interesting process with that one, but that's a whole different story. And we are based out of Brooklyn, New York and stuff like that, so we aim to not so much in quantity but in quality, where we try to push out the best sounding way we can to make you sound as best as possible as well. When it comes to the type of hardware, because we're working on actually building out a studio, physical studio, a bigger one.
Nice.
So we can have people come in and do their show from there. We even provide remote kits for folks that we feel like we can invest in to like help with, making their sound better as well. So, it's not just being online, but also having a more of a personal touch to it as well. Cool. The type of podcast network that we are.
Great. Sounds fantastic, man. Yeah. Okay. And where can they find you guys at?
They can find us at giftedsounds.com and just about anywhere you see GSN or Gifted Sounds Network. Okay. You can just find us,
Facebook, Twitter, all the usual suspects.
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, cool. All right. Lance, thank you very much for coming on. I appreciate it, man. We'll have to do this again sometime. And
for sure. Yeah, it was fun.
Yeah, it was fun for sure. Justin, thank you for staying up late as always.
And always a pleasure.
Mark, thank you for racing home from work and jumping right on.
Yeah.
Appreciate everyone. And we are the GameFellas. And that's it. We will see you next time. Later.
Peace. I'm going to look up your favorite game to see how long it takes.
Whose favorite game?
Justin's. Metal Slug takes 55 minutes.
Metal Slug.
Do you know what?
55 minutes.
That is
that's kind of long, actually, for a running gun. Yeah,
that is long, man. I think 50. That's a little bit of an overestimate there. unless they're counting the milking strats. Maybe they're counting the milking strats in there.
I mean, that is 55 minutes of your life you will never get back. So I wouldn't even bother.
A gift.
I think I found a game.
Oh, really?
Oh, here we go.
Sub-War 2050. Yeah, dude. Sub-War 2050. Yeah, I had that game. I was like, one day I'm going to get it running. <It's> never did. Never fucking did.
It looks fairly graphics intensive for the time. So yeah, that's probably why. Yeah. Oh, cool. All right. Well, mystery solved. 688 Attack Sub was the one that I played. And I think I had the Genesis port when it came on the Genesis.
Do you want to know what a really boring fact about that? If memory serves me correctly, the reason that anybody who's into video games should know 688 Attack Sub is that it was alphabetically the first title
in the library.
And so if you ever looked at a Mega Drive or a Genesis list, number one was always 688 Attack Sub.
I actually had the cartridge. I think my uncle got it for me when I was, when I first got my Genesis. It was an early Genesis game, so I actually played it, tried to play it. It was complicated as all hell. No idea what I was doing. You heard of Donanpachi, Lance? Have you ever
1 hour.
Heard
of it? Yeah, they're correct.
No, I never heard of it. What's that about?
It's a spaceship.
It's a bullet hell game.
You know?
Ah, okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Every time we come on this podcast, Mark delivers what we can only call a SHMUP date, and it's
absolutely dude.
SHMUP date. There you go.
He basically plays games that sound like the noise you make when you sneeze. So, Dodonpachi is what I sneeze. My sneeze noise.